Good morning, welcome back to Everyday Struggle. I'm Nadeska here with star and DJ Akademiks. Hey. Good morning.
What's good?
What's up, man?
Good to see you, man.
How are you?
Back to the gel tips.
Yeah.
Okay.
To get back
out. It's nothing for real. Nadeska came in today singing Drake. What's going on with you?
That was actually you, but you were so off key. I couldn't tell for a minute what you were singing. Oh, anyway,
You were quoting Look Alive.
It's summertime in New York. Feeling good? It's 72 degrees today.
I guess it's summertime.
Yep. It's going to be nice.
I'm glad I don't have to wear like fucking 5 winter coats anymore. So I'll enjoy it for like 2 days. It'll be back to like brick cold in like 3 days.
Actually, by Friday.
Yeah.
Going back down to the 40s.
That's how winter goes. All right, so let's get into today. We might as well start with one of the most important stories of the year. Young Thug officially changing his name to Sex.
Oh, shit.
From now on.
Allow me
we
to jump off the cliff, as you would say.
No parachute.
What's that?
No parachute.
Fuck that shit. This is a total exhibitionist. When we first sat down, you were talking that star, you don't know the culture shit. There's your fucking culture. Greed. Capitalism. He's changing his name. I'm so glad I saw this interview where he says it's about fashion. And then he puts the music second. Yes?
Which interview are you referencing?
You didn't see it. Okay. Hate and miss is nothing.
No. Just get your point out.
Let me take my time. So Young Thug has admitted in this recent interview that it's all about the fashion. The music is secondary. This is what Prince considered to be a charlatan. This is what The Cure considered to be a parasite. He's changing his name. There's no guidelines. And thousands of people retweeted that shit. So clearly, it's accepted. It's not a big fucking deal. Yeah, he's an exhibitionist. I have issues with people like that who just take and don't necessarily give props to what it is that they're claiming to be a part of. Again, culture, as you say. And for the record, for those who are Young Thug fans, supporters, dick riders, you know, the foundation of all forms of music is authenticity. Authenticity. So he's outright admitted that it's about the fashion first. What say you?
You said a lot, but it's not like you're trying to just call him a culture vulture. You trying to call Young Thug?
I am calling him a culture vulture. Maybe you missed that.
Okay. Well, let's just say the words. Now, this is just another, call it publicity stunt or trolling.
So he was Young Thug, then he was Jeffrey for a minute.
Well, Young Thug trolls.
And now he's Sex.
Young Thug uses social media strictly to troll. It took me a while to figure that out. I was really caught off guard when I used to see him comment on other men's picture, calling them bays and boos and his lovers. And I thought he might have been homosexual, not that there would be a problem with it, but I was like, it's a little bit weird. But I realized he does stuff for in reaction. And I think every so often he does one of these, whether it's him on a cover magazine wearing a dress, whether it's him saying his name is Jeffrey, or now nobody's, I'm not calling him Sex. Like, get the fuck out of here. So, I mean, this is just like a Twitter thing. I don't believe, well, actually, I do believe he'll probably incorporate this in some album promo. Someone says his upcoming tape, I think they're saying like Slime Season 4 or one of the Slime Seasons might be coming out soon. So it'll probably be some type of fucking little promotional plan. But that's what it is, a gimmick. It's a gimmick.
You're being dismissive, and let me call you out on your bullshit. It's deeper than that. When you talk about this word culture, you and others, and someone outright fucking admits, and he did, that it's about—
I'm talking about his tweet.
Excuse me, I'm talking about the fucking interview, when him talking, saying out of his own mouth, it's about the fashion first. You missed it, go back, please watch it, and then come back and talk about this exhibitionist. That's what he is, and I have no problem with it, but that's where we are as a society, as the genre that so many people claim is a culture. And I'm not shitting on him, I'm just calling it what it is. So he's outright admitted it's about the
fashion
first.
Do you remember the
first
interview so you're referencing? So, and are you not a fan of his music? He's put out a lot of music, right? He's dabbled in
fuck
fashion.
His music.
But he's not doing like high fashion. He did what, Calvin Klein recently. I don't think he's been doing this for a very long time. What do you think about his actual output?
I watched a couple of his videos about a year or two ago. A beautiful young fat I was hanging out with, she said, oh, you gotta check out his music. I listened to the music and then I watched the videos. You see, I do both. I don't just watch a fucking video, because if you watch a video, you can get deceived into thinking that somebody is an artist. He's not an artist, he's a charlatan.
Young Thug an artist?
No. No.
To each his own. Young Thug is one of the...
How about this? Would you agree that the foundation of all music is authenticity? You sat up here about a week or two ago when you were talking about bars. Bars matter. Okay, if bars matter, so then authenticity is the premise of all of rap music.
So yes? You're defining that here in
what
Young way?
Thug is one of the most authentic niggas we have when it comes to just being a creative in music. I think he's super authentic.
So it doesn't bother you that he said it's about fashion first, music second. It doesn't bother you.
I'm judging by his music. And his music, when I compare it to everybody
else. I'm asking
you
now about his comments out of his fucking mouth. That doesn't bother you.
Listen, Kanye West has prioritized.
You can't answer the question.
No, Kanye West has done the same.
You said something?
I'm not judging him off of those comments.
You should.
You should.
Okay, so question for you guys.
What to do. You should.
Have you listened to the rest?
I did.
I'm gonna judge him.
Are you familiar?
I'm jumping off the fucking cliff, as you said.
I'm gonna judge him.
Asking if you're familiar with his body of work, or if you just read that one interview and didn't like what he said.
I paid attention over the last maybe 2.5 years.
And so you're saying just specifically him saying that even if it's at the moment he's more interested in fashion, that doesn't make him authentic?
No. I caught him, and I'm glad that I caught him. He's admitted that it's always been about the fashion. That's what he said. It's not an argument. Let's debate it. But you know, this is what he said. I'm sorry. And to answer your question, yes, I watched his videos, and as I said, I listened to his music. I don't claim to be the sharpest knife in the fucking drawer, but when I look at the history of people that have been mistaken for just, you know, fashion statements, such as I just mentioned, The Cure, Marilyn Manson. Marilyn Manson has always had a hell of a fucking band. They go from city to city and they get down for the get down. Lady Gaga, a lot of people thought she was just, you know, just all the outfits and all this other shit. You ever seen Lady Gaga live?
How am I going to see Lady Gaga live?
It's yes or no. No, okay. Lady Gaga is a bad piano playing bitch. So that goes back to my point. We're just talking about Young Thug's fucking statements and changing his name to sex. Get the fuck out of here. I don't give a fuck.
Yeah, I mean, in promotion, niggas gonna have gimmicks. So I'm chalking this up as a gimmick, but if I listen to his music and I really see the originality that comes from the angle that he approaches shit, it's hard for me not to say he's not an artist.
Okay.
Might not be your cup of tea, but for you to outright dismiss him as original, authentic, or just saying he's not an artist, I don't know.
I think you're trying to mix up my words, and that's cute. But like I said, he has admitted that it's about the fashion first, and the music is secondary. And I have no problem with that. I just want you to fucking admit it, and he did.
I think when you try to make it either or, you're trying to put him in a box. And clearly, if we've seen Young Thug through his career, he don't want to be no type of box.
I think you should go watch the video and watch him say what he said.
Yeah, well, you just went left. We were talking about the tweet. You just went left.
I'm talking about why he changed his name to Sex, because it's about something else other than the music.
This said nothing about fashion. This just said,
so
just
what
call
if this does
sex.
Tie into an album he has coming up? So when he changed, well, when he said we should call him Jeffrey, there was a project attached. So what if there is music attached? Does that change anything for you?
It doesn't change anything. Again, I don't dislike the guy. I'm just pointing out what, you know, someone has stated with regards to, again, as you said, the culture. And I'm glad that I watched this because it confirms what I thought, you know, over the last couple of years. I didn't come at him and take shots last year or the year before. I took the time to listen to his music and also watch
the videos.
Do you
like his music?
It's half-ass, in my opinion. Nothing special.
But have you only seen the videos or have you listened to all of his projects and you
just
don't like any of it?
I've listened to the music and watched the videos. It's half-ass. He's got no classics. Nobody in 10 years is going to be screaming a fucking Young Thug song.
Okay. All right, hey, so no, I mean, we'll see.
That might be true. I don't know if he has classes, but
he's got no classes.
In my opinion, he has a lot of dope songs.
Yeah.
Killed Before, one of the best songs last year.
Okay.
All right, we'll see what happens. We'll see if music does come with this. So let's move on to Lil Yachty. So he dropped Teenage Emotions last year. He said he wasn't necessarily proud of the sales or how that project performed. So now he's confirming that his new album, Lil Boat 2, is coming March 9th, which is pretty soon. Act, do you think like Yachty's feeling a lot of pressure with this project?
I would imagine he's feeling pressure. March 9th is like 2 weeks from now, isn't it?
It's real soon.
And unless I'm just like missing something, I don't think there's a single that's like really circulating with him on now. So I'm wondering what strategy he has to release this project. Clearly, it's not a surprise release because he's announcing a date. I don't know. I'm watching to see how Yachty moves. Mm-hmm. This is very pivotal for his career because.
Do you feel like he needs a big single right now before this comes out, or can he just drop a great project?
No, I think he needed like one or two big singles mm-hmm. because. If we're just gonna go back to the origin of Lil Yachty is a, and even his image, he's almost like a pop rapper where he gets these songs that just transcend genres, transcends demographics and all that. And I think he needs something like that to drive this album. We all know he's down with QC, mm-hmm. Migos and all them. So like, of course the energy's there,
yeah.
But we need those songs from him. So I'm kind of sitting back to watch what he's gonna do and what he's gonna deliver. But March 9th is coming up pretty soon, and I haven't heard the one.
Right.
Unlike Young Thug, who is a fucking culture vulture, in case you didn't hear me clear.
I like when you get it directly.
Yeah. He's a culture vulture. Lil Yachty, I can respect him as someone who's trying to find his way. I'll say it again for those who missed it. I've worked at record labels for 8 years before ever getting to radio. Marketing, retail, promotion, flying around the country, setting up campaigns, in-stores, merchandising, all sorts of shit. He's facing he's facing what the record labels used to refer to as a feel-good song syndrome. As you just said, he put out a song that was a big crossover pop smash in hip-hop. It's a feel-good song. That song, one night, people will, in 10, 15 years, be up in a bar drinking, and when the song comes on, they'll say, hey, I remember that fucking song. That's on its way to being a classic. Would you agree? One night?
I don't know if classic, but...
Okay, anyway. So
catchy song. Young Thug has a catchy song. Good times.
I'm talking about classics, man. Pay attention.
Well, so one night isn't a classic.
Okay.
Same as Good Times.
I think that he is getting co-signed, as you just said, by the Migos and other people. So he's trying to establish his footing as a quote-unquote rapper. I can respect that, and I appreciate him trying not to just be a one-hit wonder. I think that people, as you just said, you're expecting a big single. I think the pressure is not just on him, but those around him. And sometimes an artist... cannot bounce back and get another feel-good song. And I'm not saying this to shit on him, but he may be on his way out, and I'm not wishing that upon him, but sometimes you can't reach that height again. And if the label wants you to reach that height again of that big, popular feel-good song, it could be their excuse to say, hey, it didn't work, I'm gonna drop you, thanks.
Let me call you out now.
Please.
Right?
Please.
So you said that Young Thug is a culture vulture because of a comment that he made about fashion. Well, Yachty came on Everyday Struggle last year, and he said that it's not about who's making the best music, it's about who does the best business. Isn't that almost the same, where he's not that focused, or he's not focused on making the best music, he's focused on just having his business right, whether in or outside of music?
Well, you don't have to call me out. If those are the statements out of his mouth, yeah. then maybe he is a culture vulture. I don't know. I'm talking about him coming back with another song to reach the height of One Night. If he sounds like a culture vulture to you, call him out. Call him a fucking culture vulture.
I don't think that's a culture vulture, though. So that's why I'm trying to get your definition straight, right? Not because someone has other interests. I feel like all these rappers are brands, right? So... like ASAP Rocky, like his brand goes into fashion. Kanye goes into fashion. Young Thug brand also goes into fashion. His brand is just really on a business level, kind of mixing with that middle America audience. And I think he realized that he'll probably make more money outside of music than in music. Doesn't mean he's a culture vulture. It means he's used music to travel to other places. And I don't have a problem with that, but you know what I mean? I've seen you call out Young Thug. I'm wondering, what's the difference here?
I don't have a problem with that either, if that's what he's admitting to. As you just said, he mm-hmm. came on your show. I didn't see the episode, pardon me. Yeah. He's admitting to it's about business as opposed to just rapping and music. Is that what Lil Yachty said?
Yeah, when I asked him about who was making the best music, he said it's not about who's making the best music,
okay.
It's about who's doing the best business.
Okay.
And, I mean, I completely understand what he was saying, But if I was going in your terms, it feel like
I think he has to say that because again he's got the pressure upon him now as we just all agreed that he's got to come back just as strong or stronger than what he has already may become successful for. So he's gonna say something to that effect. And I'm not saying that he's not a culture vulture. I'm just going by what if we can go back to Young Thug for a second, his statements saying that it's about fashion first. He outright said it's about fashion first and the music second. So, I mean, you can compare the two. If Lil Yachty's a culture vulture, then fuck him. He's a culture vulture too. I don't give a fuck. I'm not here caping for that nigga.
Yeah, I will say in terms of pressure, the reason why I think he's feeling pressure, right? The Migos just did some great numbers, and I feel like everyone in this camp is progressing, and if he takes a step back on this album, as you said, they might look at him like, you might be on your way out.
Yeah. What do you think he would do differently this time? Like, what were his complaints from the first time around?
So some of the complaints is that the album was too lengthy. Mm-hmm. I believe it was about almost 20 tracks, or maybe more than 20. We know it worked for the Migos, but the Migos, they had a different momentum. He got to come with less tracks, mm-hmm. and also he changed his style a little bit in terms of what the fans wanted from him. So just go back to, like, just give the niggas what they want, man. Like, don't try reinventing the wheel. Give the niggas what they want. And also just hopefully get those big songs. That's it.
All right, so hopefully we can have some fun with this next one. It's just a meme posing a very important question. Hypothetically, who would make the better collab album, Jay-Z and Drake or Nas and Cole? What do you guys think?
I'm going to go with Nas and Cole. You know what I mean?
Really?
Just out of chemistry. Not that I personally want to listen to. Actually, I wouldn't mind. But they got the chemistry. Both of them could be on some woke shit. You know what I mean? Like, they could definitely give us a cohesive body of work addressing a ton of issues that's going on in society and also in hip-hop. Both of them have done it. Drake and Jay, although great artists independently, I'm just trying to think cohesively, like content-wise, what would they put together as an album? Drake on some emotional shit.
Yeah, but
Jay's
think about
rapping
songs
about
like
401Ks. I don't think.
What about like Pound Cake, Paris Morton music, Light Up? You didn't like any of those? It's interesting because they all have interesting relationships. We know that J. Cole
very
let Nas
thing.
Down and made
I'll
up.
Get
and
killed for this. I'm definitely gonna get killed
come on,
for this.
Come on.
Was it a Pound Cake? I'm not that big fan of that Pound Cake song.
Okay.
A collab with Drake and Jay. The Light Up joint, cool, mm-hmm. because it was very prophetic. But nah. A whole album, as I said, Drake album content is emotional. Mm-hmm. Jay at this point is rapping about 401K and fucking prostate. Okay.
So you think Drake the content would align?
I'm sorry. Are Drake and Jay-Z cool now? I know they had tension.
They probably beefing behind the scenes.
It's always up and down, right?
Yeah, unless
love, hate,
unless it's
adoration.
Dropped on Tidal, this is not coming out, right?
I don't do hypotheticals. I don't like to imagine what could be. I just like to deal with what is. But for conversation, I would say Drake and Jay-Z. Drake is more of the now. He's a fast writer, regardless of who you say or who anybody says writes his shit. He puts out music that is more of the pulse of the nation. Nas is my guy. I'm one of the few people that supported Nas when I was on Hot 97 in New York City in his very famous battle against Jay-Z. But Nas is a slow writer. It takes him a long time to put things together. And he puts together brilliant work. Mm-hmm. But in today's day and time, you have to put it out fast. And I don't think that Nas would be able to put out material fast enough with J. Cole, who is brilliant. I like J. Cole. I don't think Nas could put it together that fast.
J. Cole ain't putting shit out fast either. J. Cole disappeared. He'd
okay,
be on a milk
so,
carton.
They would work on
go.
The same wavelength.
There you go, same wavelength.
But would you want this, like, if this is an iconic collab either way, right? I don't want them to put it out fast. I want something where it feels like you guys worked on it for
well,
such a long time.
Well, I'm talking
time,
about so that it would resonate with the pulse of the nation again, because everybody can put out tracks fast now. People put out a diss track, somebody's coming back at you a fucking week later. It's not like, you know, before where it took a month or, you know, you were given the time. So to answer the question, I would say Drake and Jay-Z, but I would really like to see R. Kelly and Jay-Z get back together. And
all right, so things that are never, ever going to happen. All right, cool.
And do a third album.
And speaking of Pulse of the Nation, though, I do think being on some, like, very woke shit. That is a pulse of the nation. Kendrick is fucking dominating that. So Nas and Cole?
I think Nas is brilliant. But again, the way he has put together his music in the past, it takes him a while. And he even admitted it. I'm not saying nothing sideways. I mean, that's my guy.
No. Maybe we're not connecting on what do you mean by the pulse of the nation. When I hear that, I think music that's in touch with issues or
right.
whatever that's going
right.
on now.
Right.
And I believe like Cole has been making music, also Kendrick, that deals with oppression and deals with the plight of black people. And I think that's been the pulse of the nation for the last couple of years. Nas and Cole, they would body that shit.
I hear you. I don't think we have so much of an argument. Again, this is a hypothetical. Yeah. I don't like to hash out hypotheticals. But we're talking about an album. An album's worth of material. And will it resonate at this particular point in time? Drake crosses boundaries that Nas has never crossed. Drake affects different nationalities and ethnicities. You go to a Drake concert, you see a sea of different people. It's not just black people, as you mentioned.
Okay.
I mean, same with Cole.
Okay.
You both made your good points. All right, so we spoke early in the week about Fergie sort of butchering the anthem at All-Star Weekend. She's still catching some heat for it, so here's Wendy Williams adding her commentary and calling out a few other people who she thinks need auto-tune.
There are only a few people who can sing Raw Dog, and Fergie is not one. She needs auto-tune. Jen Lopez needs auto-tune. And Janet needs auto-tune. And Beyonce needs auto-tune.
They'd be like gonna cancel her down, so.
Adele, Aretha, Celine, Dionne Warwick, and Mariah. They need nothing.
All right, so she could have stopped at just naming Fergie here, but she took it that extra step, even dropping Beyonce in there. You guys feel like this was worth
it? I'm going to hate on an old friend, so you go first.
Man, nobody wants smoke with a beehive. She was cool with every name she dropped until she said Beyonce. I think that's where she fucked up. She is right, though, with the names that she listed of the people that don't need autotune. Mm-hmm. And her overall premise is right. I think people would disagree with Beyonce just being on the list that needs autotune.
Yeah.
But she's 100% right. I mean, some of these people who sound great on record, they're not good live. Mm. And I mean, I don't want to throw anyone under the bus now, but like people who we love, they're not good live. You know what I mean? They're good on a record. And we see them get exposed time and time again when they do late night shows or they do anything that's acoustic driven where they actually have to perform.
Yeah.
They can't really perform live. And I guess that's why it goes back to the All-Star game or the NBA All-Star game. They fucked up by booking Fergie. If you know she can't perform live, like she can't, she's not gonna sound like how she sounds on a record. So you're booking her for what you're gonna get. Okay. So, but Wendy, you're brave for throwing Beyonce on that list.
Star, what do you think?
Last time I checked, Wendy and I are very, very cool. She was instrumental in my radio rise.
She's a radio legend.
What's that?
She's a radio legend.
Yes. But she's talking a little reckless, and she has to because she's trying to cover up some things about her own personal life that she has not been open and honest about. I'm not going to get into that right now, but I look at her now and I see some of the things that she says, and I'm like, okay, whatever. But with regards to her statements about, you know, the current singers of today, you know, she's making reference to a different time when people sang different, the melodies were different, the musical approach, the orchestration, all that shit was different. So people use auto-tune today. I don't think it's so much of a necessity. People do it sometime because they like the way it sounds. She made one reference here very, very incorrectly, Adele. Adele is a fucking choke artist, especially on award shows. Yeah, don't look at me like
Adele?
I'm crazy. Have you seen Adele choke at the last couple of award shows? She had to start over with that whole George Michael tribute right in the middle of the fucking goddamn song because she was off key and she was flat. So Wendy's saying things now that, you know, I guess it sound good for some people, but in reality, you know, auto-tune is what people use. It's what the market calls for.
Yeah, I'm gonna disagree with the Adele thing. Adele did have some vocal issues, but I think she even had surgery at one point. But she is, when I have seen her perform live, she's usually phenomenal. So.
All right, so a little bit of positivity in all of this. Thanks to Wiz Khalifa, as always. Always has something nice to say. Man.
What's that?
They hate constantly, man. So you say Adele is just trash?
Are you going back now?
Nah, man, I just want
to. She was moving forward. You want to go back? Let's go back.
We could go back forward anywhere.
I'm sorry, you were saying?
Wiz Khalifa just
fuck
wanted
Adele.
To jump in.
How about
in.
That? Fuck Adele.
That's, you speaking only for yourself and no one else,
I'm speaking
period.
For myself. Motherfuck Adele.
All right.
Choking ass bitch. Pardon me. Go ahead.
Wiz Khalifa, I liked Fergie's national anthem. It was original and fun, just like her. He said people didn't like Jimi Hendrix's version of the anthem at the time, but it later became legendary. It takes guts to be yourself. Wiz is just always trying to spread love and positivity. Shout out to him.
He's a great guy. You met him?
We need some great guys.
Yeah, you met him?
Yeah, like in work interview study, yeah. Sure.
He's caping for Fergie. So salute to Wiz. She was horrible, homie. I don't know. He just. I think the consensus is that, you know, it was. Yes, she tried, and we're going back to Fergie. She tried, but it was, as you would say, super trash. It was trash.
Yeah, it was trash. But I have seen another angle of how people are looking at it by saying that we knew she was trash, but at least she went in and she did what we expected her to do. Not like fucking outperformed and like, if you know somebody can't shoot free throws and you put them on the free throw line, they miss. The fuck? Like, you knew what you were gonna get. So I think some people are saying it takes a lot of guts to not try to fucking sing like you don't sing. You were yourself in front of millions of people. You knew you were gonna get embarrassed and clown, and you did it anyway, and you're sticking by it.
And let me just correct Wiz Khalifa, because he made the poor analogy to Jimi Hendrix. You know, when Jimi Hendrix performed the Star Spangled Banner at Woodstock many, many moons ago, it wasn't that his rendition was a bad rendition. It was looked upon as sacrilege. Here you are, a black guy, playing the Star Spangled Banner, and you're putting it into your own version. That was the issue with Jimi Hendrix. Not that he couldn't play, because he played the shit out of it. Mm. A similar reference to, I forget the year, this is going way far back, Jose Feliciano performed, I think it was the national anthem, this is going way far back, but if we're talking about, you know, people making attempts or redoing national anthems and things like that, Jose Feliciano did it once upon a time, and he was hated upon because he was a Puerto Rican man. How dare you touch this? So Wiz Khalifa, great guy, but he must be high when he must have been high when he made these comments.
He stays high.
Yeah, he stays high.
And in a good
but
mood.
He's a great guy.
And in a good mood. There's nothing wrong with that. All right, so our can't unsee it today is Twista at All-Star Weekend. Apparently, after an event, he took a shuttle back to the hotel parking lot. There was a guy on the bus heckling other passengers, including women. So he and another guy decided to step in. Let's take a look.
Hey,
we needed the slow motion, but some good teamwork in this video to handle heckler.
Jump in here.
I'm just wondering how this whole thing unfolded. I don't even believe that whole story. Like, oh yeah,
he's on the shuttle.
Fuck out of here. They just made that shit up. This is Twista and his homie stomping somebody the fuck out for whatever reason. I just think Twista, after he held homie in the headlock while the other guy got some rib shots in, he should let the other dude hold him while he got some shots in. You know what I mean? You got to get your shots in too. But I really want to know why this happened. I don't believe that story.
You don't believe the heckling? Why?
No, I don't believe that.
They're not just being good public servants?
No. You were heckling. It just sounds too perfect. You were heckling a woman, and I stepped in to beat your ass. Fuck out of here. I don't believe that shit. I believe that they were probably just talking shit to each other, and a fight erupted. Twista got his people with him, and they fucked him up. That's what happened.
Such a realist star.
Twist is a really nice, mild-mannered guy. I like him, and I don't usually like too many fucking people, especially when I'm interviewing them. I just want to get to the heart of the matter, whatever that may be. And he's just a very mild-mannered guy. And I think that whatever caused this to happen must have really affected him personally. Maybe he was drinking, smoking, I don't know. But my thing is, if the person who Twist had put in a headlock now files a lawsuit will twist to be charged as an accessory. Or sometimes, and I may be reaching here, sometimes...
No, he's involved in the assault.
What's that?
Fucking accessory. He's involved in the assault.
Exactly. But now, sometimes when you detain a person, depending on the state, that can be a kidnapping charge. I know that sounds crazy, but sometimes if you prevent a person from going on, I forget the technical terms, going on their way or something to that effect, you can be charged with kidnapping. So we could have just watched some real fucking... charges that are going to come down the pipe. But he's a nice guy. I don't know what happened. It seems like somebody just really got to him, you know.
Listen, much man, there. Salute to my nigga Twist. At least he ain't go out like Flavor Flav. You know what I mean? He was putting in the work. Nah, it's real. You know what I mean? He was putting in the work. Him and his team rather than them getting the work. You know what I mean? Good shit. I'm glad, you know what I mean? He doing Chicago proud over there. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Can you tell us what is the plan when you go on tour to do shows? I'm just curious. You said you got a team.
Oh, yeah, of course. I mean, I have a team when I'm going to anywhere that's going to be public that people know.
Can you give us a little insight? Do you tell people if so-and-so touches me, put hands on them or just fall back? What is it you say? Because that's very, very important when you're out and about. Yeah, how you react and respond.
We're going to save that for when it happens. I'm not over here. They're going to chop this and use it in court. Fuck out of here. This guy's trying to set a nigga up.
Star on the sucker shit.
Yeah, trying to set me up. Well, he set on everyday struggle. He told his mans to do it. I ain't telling nobody to do anything. I don't tell nobody to do anything.
Can I give you some advice?
Go ahead. Carry a gun?
Well, that's what I do, but you know, keep a drink in your hand. If shit gets real, just throw a drink on a person. Don't throw a punch.
That might work for a chick, but like, these niggas, they coming with the fist.
Throwing a drink on someone beats the assault charge.
But suppose they come back with a bunch of fists. They
if they come back with a fist, then you're just defending yourself. Telling
all right, there you go. Some life advice.
I'm trying to help you out. Throw some water. I just threw water on them.
Okay.
That's a loving hip hop maneuver. Just so throw the water.
I've been doing that since 2001, man. Motherfuck loving hip hop.
Stay out of trouble, Ack.
Yeah. All right. I'm always on defense.
All right, so R. Kelly may be having a bad week. According to the Daily Mail, he's being evicted from one of his Georgia mansions. He owes about $23,000 in back rent. This is allegedly where he holds or operates his alleged sex cults. I don't know. He does have other mansions. Does this matter to R. Kelly? He's probably just going to find another mansion somewhere.
Yeah, man. Well, R. Kelly like Birdman in the sense that they got hella mansions. One mansion is done. He got another dungeon somewhere else where he's going to have these. You know what I mean? He got a whole little kidnap brothel going on. Did we hear about the women who were probably staying at this hostel?
No, and of course, R. Kelly still maintains that he's innocent. There's no like current charges against him, so...
R. Kelly got a whole little, it's definitely not funny, he got a whole little sex trafficking joint going on through his mansions, and I don't know, I'm just praying, even this where'd you find this picture, Chops? Even a chick in this picture looked like she's been held hostage. Look at this shit. Man, I love Kelly's music, man, but I think certain shit we see in the media is hard to just appreciate him being a legendary musician without thinking that shit constantly. Like when we hear about a mansion, all we can think about is how many young women have lost their fucking... Star, you take it off, my nigga.
R. Kelly, in my opinion, stays freaking bitches. And this was a rental mansion. This wasn't something that he owned. Very different from what Birdman went through, losing the mansion by way of default on a loan payment. R. Kelly and his team just burnt out the place and they said, fuck it, we're out of here, everybody pack your shit. And the place was probably wrecked, trashed, and that's what insurance is for. It's not a big deal. It's not like he couldn't pay the money. He just said, fuck it, I don't want to pay, what is it, $23,000? Fuck it, sue me, or maybe we can hash it out, or I'll give you part of it. So when we say kicked out, sometimes people go through, whether it be artists, entertainers, and they destroy a place because they're having parties or just, you know, freak situations. And that's probably what happened. I don't know for certain. But again, he didn't lose this place because he couldn't pay the note. It's not like he's fucking destitute or trying to get his finances together. Mm-hmm. Birdman, who I fuck with heavy, baby, had issues with paying the goddamn mortgage. R. Kelly has just now moved on to another place, a new palace. He's gonna be freaking more bitches, pardon me, and that's just what it is.
Man, yeah, but
well, come on and get your freak on. That's what it is.
Yeah, but he's having hostages. Star, like
I don't know this. If you want to say that, you say that.
Well, according to the mother of one of the women,
I'm separating myself from this nigga right now. I don't know if he has hostages.
Nah, I mean, there have been a lot of long reports about this.
According to the mother of one of the women who was taking selfie videos, sending it to TMZ in parks that she couldn't tell her location in. The mother and the family of that chick says, no, R. Kelly got her daughter as a hostage. We
accusation.
Can't even
say- Accusations.
Well, I mean, listen. It's also accused that he was on video with underage girls. But
I don't know that to be true.
There's a video, my nigga.
I didn't see it. All right. You watched it?
Listen. It exists.
You're just trying to be cute right now. Let's move on to quick hits.
It exists.
All right, Tekashi 69, a new project's on the way. Day 69, now we have the track list, features from Tory Lanez, Young Thug. Offset, are we excited about this project? 11 songs, not too long.
I ain't gonna lie. I ain't gonna sound biased, but this shit is fire. I heard
already?
It.
Oh, whoa, you heard, okay.
Whoa. I heard it.
You heard it's the full
fire.
Thing.
I heard the full thing, it's fire.
Two weeks ago, you said he was gonna bomb, he was gonna flop. He was going to put out trash.
Actually, I thought it was going to be trash.
How many hits on this?
Until I heard the motherfucker, and I was like, that chocolate track?
Wow.
That is fire. Billy is super fire. We heard Gummo. The Rondo track, Young Thug comes in and fucking moonwalks on a beat like Michael Jackson. Okay, Tory Lanez does his thing. Kiki already is a hit. And the weird thing is just the naming scheme, the 93, Dewey, Bubba. But all of these are hot. All these are hot, I'm not gonna lie.
Wow.
If I'm gonna do projections, he's gonna sell at least 40,000 records first week.
Okay, I have not heard it. I'll wait. I like to wait. I don't like to just assume and speculate, you know, because it just.
That was so definitive though, calling them all hits. That was, okay.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to it now.
Well, no, they sound great. This tape sounds good. Mm-hmm. I thought it was going to be trash because once, and I'm going off the formula of you have three songs that work. Now the label is saying, fuck, we need an album that people could buy. Get in the studio for 2 weeks, create some shit. Mm-hmm. Once you create it, we're going to put that out for sale. 2 weeks, sometimes you can't come up with great material. Now, apparently, he's been working on this for like 6-7 months.
I was just about to say, you were in the studio with him last month.
Yeah.
Yeah? So didn't you hear bullshit then when you came on here and you said he was going to put out bullshit?
No, I only heard singles.
Oh.
So I didn't hear the full thing. So I thought like he rushed like all these other songs like in the last like month or so. But apparently, he had these songs done months ago.
So this is some new shit?
Yeah, they're new to the majority appeal, but he'd been had it done.
So he's about to bring the fire. He's about to be a major fucking factor is what you're saying.
Yo, if he don't get killed, man, in San Antonio or wherever else he goes on a tour, he has a hot tape coming out.
Okay.
He has a hot tape coming out. Which, by the way, I actually project him outselling Lil Pump's on...
Stop it.
No, Lil Pump sold 37,000 on his first...
You sound like Tekashi's now got you under pressure.
Nah. All right.
Niggas got in the DM.
Wait, do you want to make a bet?
What's that?
First week sales. He's going to outsell.
I don't give a fuck what he sells.
Exactly.
First week.
Exactly.
All right, so the Ray Shormer triple disc album is on the way now that we know that Travis Scott's going to be featured.
Okay.
Excited about this?
Wait, we just know Travis Scott's going to be on. I can imagine everybody's gonna on be. It's a triple disc joint, right? Like, there got to be a bunch of features on here. Again, I'm just looking for the 20 songs that Sway Lee said are replicas or are just as good as Unforgettable. Because that got snubbed for a Grammy, and he said, don't worry, I got 20 more of those. And anytime an artist say that, and I'm going to believe Sway Lee, it better be that. So I'm looking for those tracks, and if they're there, it's going to be fucking amazing.
I'm confused because you did say a couple of weeks ago that you weren't anticipating anything with more than 20 tracks. Now you're saying you're waiting for it. I'm just going by your words. I don't anticipate anything. I'll review it when it comes out.
I'll clear up your confusion.
Please.
I'm talking about the quality of the music that's going to be on there.
Okay.
Sway Lee says he has 20 tracks that's like unforgettable. Now, I just want those tracks, right? This thing might have like 30-something tracks. I'm really not interested in listening to anything past 20. Truth be told.
Okay.
So the length of the project, and also trying to pair both solo projects with the joint project, I know it's been done before, I'm not too interested in. However, I'll check it out. I'm just hoping that all those hits that he was talking about are on this tape.
Okay.
All right, we'll see. We just need all these projects to come. Last quick hit, just Jay-Z being Jay-Z. So he took one OG Perez, that's the president of Roc Nation Sports, out to celebrate his birthday and dropped a cool, what, $91,000 plus tip, maybe over $100,000 on a night out. So here's a waitress. She shared a snap of it. People are surprised, but should we really be surprised? This seems like a normal night out for Jay.
I think that the waitress should be reprimanded, first of all. I think that's really just, you know, that type of shit has got to stop. Even if somebody gives you a small tip, come on, you snapshot and fucking receipts. I mean, salute to Jay-Z, he's a baller, that's what you do. But I just, my issue would be with whoever snapped the fucking receipt and put that out. That was on your IG page, yes?
Mm-hmm.
So the waitress actually did that?
Yeah, something like that. Well, actually, I forgot who put that out. That might have even been like someone close to Jay.
I thought they said a waitress put it on her snap, allegedly. I don't know. Apparently bought like 40 bottles of Ace of Spades champagne.
I mean, I only look at this to say, I mean, Jay's fucking like a billionaire. So like,
that's light.
Like, yeah, that's light to him.
That's light.
Somebody did give me a goddamn Ace of Spades joint, and I didn't know it cost that much, and I still ain't drinking. I'm about to sell
everything's
that bitch.
A little more expensive at a club or a
bar,
though.
I'm selling that bitch. Y'all don't see me put up Ace of Spades on eBay tonight. Okay. I don't need 1,200. I just need like, six.
I saw some people online saying, and a good amount of people saying that money could have been used for something else, yada, yada, yada.
He's rich.
The timing, I think people compare it to like Drake giving out a million.
Right.
Like Drake gave out a million, you're spending $100,000 in the club. You get me?
If I can just say, and not that I have to defend Jay-Z's actions, but you know, sometimes, or a lot of the times, it's just, you're in a certain zone, you're in a moment, you're with friends, you're with constituents, you're with people that you're about to do business with. So this is light, as we just said. It's not that big of a deal, but you know, salute to the broke Aggie niggas had to look at that and say, wow, I could use those 91 racks, you know.
Yeah. He earned those, he's good. let him do what he wants.
And also, like, I'm glad that you could tell Jay went out of his way, or maybe not went out of his way, but he definitely tried to make sure his man had a good birthday.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Some of these broke-ass niggas, they'll let you pay on your own birthday. So I got to hats off to
Jay. I hope you're not one of those friends.
And also, do you buy bottles at the club?
I try not to. Nigga, I try to drink going to the club. You know what I mean? Man, actually, y'all went to AC one time. Man.
Atlantic City?
Yeah, and I got like the whole joint. I was ordering all type of shit, man. It came to like $1,600. I'm like, what the fuck? Nah, for real, they're charging like $400 for a small bottle of Syrah. I ain't into that, man. I go to a liquor store right around the corner from me, and I'm copping that shit for $40.
Pre-game. There's no shame in a pre-game.
Nigga shit.
Yes. I am super on the nigga. I might even sneak liquor into the club. Yeah, I'm on
I do that all the time.
Though. Okay, so you on the nigga shit
okay,
too?
Okay, there you go.
Hey, here we go.
Getting Jay-Z money.
Imagine spending $1,600, well, $91,000. Well, that's for him.
I couldn't imagine that, yeah.
Yeah, hell fucking no. But it is what it is.
The pregame. All right, guys, thank you for watching Everyday Struggle. Back same time tomorrow on Complex News.